Thank you so much. So, first of all, hello everyone, and thank you so much for joining us today. I hope you are having a great, sessions and great day and staying safe. And I want to thank All Things Open for inviting me to speak with you today. Also, thanks everyone for joining again. So, let's get started. And starting with just a second. Yeah, it's The topic for the day is digital discrimination, cognitive bias in machine learning. So, my name is Sai Shruti, and I work for IBM Center for Open Source Data and AI Technologies, and we call this as CODITE. And I'm a data scientist and developer advocate. My team builds and maintains open source AI projects for IBM and makes it possible for open source to be used on enterprise platforms. This means maintaining documentation, supporting product adoption of open source projects, building relationships, and contributing to key external projects and communities. And most important thing is vetting licensing. So as you can see on the screen, these are the projects that we contribute to currently. And we also work with a product team, in adoption of the open source projects, as I have mentioned before. Yes, so getting to the topic of the day, right? I'm just so thrilled to just get started with today's topic. So today I'll discuss why it is imperative to focus on AI ethics in AI and in tech, right? In general, in tech, why it is important to focus on ethics and how, bias can take root in machine learning algorithms and what are the ways that we can overcome it. So machine learning algorithms, to start with, impact our lives every day in ways that, we may not even realize. So for example, nowadays AI is making decisions like who gets a bonus, a job interview. So whether or not your credit card limit is raised or even who gets into a medical clinical trial. And most importantly, machine learning algorithms are even making decisions about who gets parole and who languishes in prison, right? So on that topic, I want to make a disclaimer that while I do work for IBM, I will be sharing some of my own personal opinions here, and I'm not here in an official capacity or as a spokesperson for IBM, though I'll be talking about the open source project work done by my team at IBM. Today, I'll be using an example from the judicial system here in the United States. I will not be describing violence, but I will speak about the inequalities that exist in the system and ways that technology today can automate injustice. These are with a genuine interest of creating a trusted and equal community. I hope we are all here for the same. I also assume you are here today because you are passionate about technology and you care about building things that make a positive impact in society. I can attempt to provide you with some more tools to move forward in this space as well, that you can start exploring and try to implement them in our day-to-day, if at all you're creating any applications with artificial intelligence. So from here, moving on to the agenda. So here is a loose agenda for this talk. We will discuss public examples of bias in machine learning. We will then talk about industry specific solution to combat injustice in this area. We will discuss open source tool for combating unwanted bias and increasing transparency. And then we will end with resources and ways for you to get involved in this area. I hope the introduction is pretty clear and all of us are excited to get started with. And feel free to, ask questions and, start our interaction. So I feel this is very important for us to discuss and each of us learn from each other. So, cognitive bias. Let's think more about this term. What is cognitive bias? A cognitive bias is a deviation from a rationality in judgment. Basically, you create your own reality through your perception of something, right? So an important thing to note is that you don't know about your own cognitive biases. For example, now people make decisions about the world around them given their very limited resources, right? We know about, you know, certain things in a very like a small way, but when you see, we start being judgmental about things around us, even though we know we have been provided with a very limited resources to make those judgments. You can only learn about your cognitive biases through input and feedback from other people, cultures, background, experiences, and so on. So, for example, I'm here and I have been told certain things during my childhood. So when I see certain things, I just like that make a judgment. Although I know the people whom I'm interacted with or the books that I read, for example, are very limited to make those judgments. So machine learning is not immune to this very human state. Cognitive bias in machine learning is the existence of the irrational bias in the output of machine learning model. All machine learning models are trained to discriminate from one outcome or the other based on how they are built and make decisions based on the data that they are given. It's very simple. Like, what you give is what you get. If you give like a limited data, the output may not be right all the time. But AI is trained, if the AI is trained using the biased data and it reproduces the inequality that already exists in the world. It's we humans who feed the data to the system, and we have to be cautious about it. If you're feeding biased data and the outcome is going to be, you know, biased results as well. I'm going to start, you know, showing there are many examples of bias in machine learning. You know, we continue to see them in news. So here I'm going to present, you know, some very like a popular example that's out and we all are aware of. But to get started with, let's just see what is that. In 2008, Broward County Sheriff Office in Fort Lauderdale decided that instead of building another jail, it would begin using North Point's risk score to help identify which defendants were low risk enough to be released on bail pending trial, right? This algorithm is called COMPASS algorithm. Since then, nearly everyone arrested in the county has been scored soon after being booked. I hope everyone, most of us here are aware of this, you know, this algorithm, COMPASS algorithm. If you are not, let's know more about it. The executive director of the community program for the county sheriff office said the county chose North Point software over other tools because it was easy to use and it's easy to produce results, right? It's simple yet effective charts and graphs for judicial review. That was the statement. And the system cost is about $22,000 a year. ProPublica obtained the risk scores assigned to more than 7,000 people arrested in the county in 2013 and 14, and they checked how many were charged with new crimes over the next 2 years. And they used the same benchmark used by the creators of the algorithm. Right? Basically, they were testing the risk scores that were given to the people who are being arrested. So first scenario here. So this is the, you know, as you can see on the screen, this is the article. I can post this on the channel if anyone wants to, you know more about it. Okay, let's quickly see the first example. So I'll be going through very few examples of some people who committed similar crimes and were affected by the scores by COMPASS algorithm. A lower score means less likeliness of reoffending and thus lower bail or less jail time. And the high score means higher chance of reoffending and thus higher bail or more jail time. You will notice a pattern here. The first one, as you can see on the screen, Brisha was rated high risk for future crime after she and a friend took a kid's bike and scooter valued at $80 and they were sitting outside. She was 18 and had a record, but only for misdemeanors when she was a minor. And the next, and on the left side, you can see Vernon was picked up for shoplifting $86.35 worth of tools from a nearby Home Depot store. He was more seasoned criminal. He had already been convicted of armed robbery and attempted armed robbery for which he served 5 years in prison, in addition to another armed robbery charge. While Borden did not reoffend, Brisha did not reoffend, and Vernon is serving an 8-year prison term for subsequently breaking into a warehouse and stealing thousands of dollars worth of electronics. But if you see the score, the risk is 8 for Brisha and Vernon it's 3. And here is the next example. So apologies if, the spelling, if I'm just misspelling some of the names. I hope feel free to correct me. And Gregory crashed his Lincoln Navigator into Toyota Camry while drunk. He was rated as a low risk of reoffending despite the fact it was at least his fourth, such incident, right? He was given a risk score of 1, whereas the person on the right, Mallory, was given risk score of 6. Now, this is the most important part. I really like this, the graph when reading more about it. So I'm going to show you two charts here that show the average scores assigned to criminal defendants based on skin color. Here you see the average score assigned to Black defendant across 7,000 people that ProPublica reviewed. You will notice a fair amount of Black people evaluated were at high risk score. And the second graph. And here, the scores for white defendants. This chart shows that scores for white defendants were skewed towards low risk categories. Scores for Black defendants were not. In forecasting who would reoffend, right, the algorithm made mistakes with Black and white defendants at roughly the same rate, but in different ways. Let's see how and what are the different ways. First one, the formula was particularly likely to falsely flag Black defendant as future criminals, wrongly labeling them this way at most twice the rate as white defendant. And white defendant were mislabeled as low risk more often than Black defendants. And Black defendants were 77% more likely to be, marked as high risk of committing future crime, and 45% more likely to be predicted to commit a future crime of any kind, right? So North Point disputes this ProPublica's result, and North Point software continues to be, the most widely used assessment tools in the country. And they have since changed their name of their company to Equivant. So I'm just pausing here to see if there is any comment or questions.
Hi, I'm here. It looks like people are still taking it in. There's the last long conversation is about pronouns, but there is interest in this topic. So I imagine that we'll be getting some stuff. They're sort of waiting for you to come to a place of conclusion, I think, or make a statement about how it should change.
Sure. So quickly going through this one, due to algorithmic decision making, populations that are disproportionately targeted by law enforcement, especially, the low income and minority communities are being slapped with high recidivism scores. As a result, the algorithm, it amplifies and perpetuates embedded bias and it generates even more biased data to feed, you know, the cycle. In machine learning, yes, you have the data, you train the system, you create an application, and that application is going to generate your future data. Imagine you're taking the data back and you're feeding it to retrain your model. So your entire system throughout its cycle is going to learn your biased data. And now imagine how the outcome is going to be, right? So at the Data for Black Life conference in January, they actually spoke about this problem. So Data for Black Life is a group of activist organizers and mathematicians committed to the mission of using data science to create concrete and measurable change in lives of Black people. So there's one quote from Rashida, Director of Policy Research at AI Now Institute, drove this home in, so I'm just going to quote it, in my experience in conversations around AI, people talk about it just like, you know, the list of pros and cons. Okay, you have a system, what is the pros, what is the cons? But that's the moment of power and privilege to be able to determine that it's okay that some folks are disproportionately harmed. So it's very important as a creator of the system, as a user of a system, to understand the pros and cons and to use this to determine if anyone, no, if any particular community is being treated with inequality. So next I'm going to talk about, in February 2018, Joy, a computer scientist and digital activist based at MIT Media Lab, ran this gender shade project. The goal of this project is to see how well different gender classification system worked across different people faces and if the results changed, you know, based on somebody's gender or skin type. Her team analyzed three companies, Microsoft, Face++, and IBM. So IBM had the largest gap in accuracy with a difference of 34.4% in error rate between the lighter males and darker females. I'm going to quote Joy's point here. After looking at this, it's like we have entered the age of automation, overconfident, yet underprepared. And now if we fail to make ethical and inclusive artificial intelligence, we risk losing gains made in civil rights and gender equity under the guise of mission neutrality. Now, in January 2019, Joy released an update to gender shades by retesting the previous system she had examined using the same benchmark as before and expanding her review to include Amazon recognition and a new system from a small AI company called Kairos. There is some good news here. She found that IBM, Face++, and Microsoft had seen significant improvement in their gender classification for darker skinned women, with Microsoft reducing their error rate below 2%. Joyce said that the study shows the need for this technology to be externally audited in order to hold them technically accountable. So this is the screenshot from Joyce's talk at FAT conference, in which she talks about the follow-up from the Gender Shade project. She said that IBM gave the quickest response and the most thorough response to this work. IBM Research flew her to our headquarters in New York and worked closely with her to improve our public API and methods that we recommend for classifying and scoring using our tools, and found significant improvements through hand-in-hand collaboration with her and her team. Now it's time to talk about, you know, solution in this, to this very, very serious problem. I'm just pausing to see if there is any chat. Yes. First thing, education is key. better education is key to encourage more people to consider, you know, those affected by their algorithm once they are out in the world, you know, when we are building things for real people. So it's very, very important to educate both the creators and the users and the evaluators. Next, we need to recognize that the choice we make in building these new technologies can have a dire social ramifications. As such, universities, you know, they have started beginning to require computer science majors to take ethics and morality in computer science courses. Cornell, Harvard, MIT, and Stanford are among the colleges offering these courses. So it's very, very important from my perspective as well to educate people, you know, to really think about the consequence of what we develop. And these are the questions that are posted to the students. The first is, the technology really fair? How do we make sure, you know, that the data is not biased? Should the machines be judging humans? The new ethic courses covers topics like artificial intelligence and autonomous machines, privacy and civil rights, and platforms like Facebook. Red Hat founded Black in AI. Black in AI started as a community where Black people could come together who might not have had the opportunity to meet each other otherwise. You know, the goal is to diversify the field and increase number of Black people who enter and stay in the field, so that people who ask the question and set the objective in building AI becomes more diverse, right? So the algorithms, when you build team with a diverse set of, you know, creators, when people from different field, people from different backgrounds start building the system, is when your system will be trained on more diverse data and will have less bias. I wouldn't put it as like no bias, I would put it as less bias. And I'm gonna leave the quote here because I wanna share more about the tools, and I'll share the presentation later for all of us to take a look at it. So now this is something really interesting that I came across. So now there's a great example of what happens when you diversify your team, right? Now we spoke about, yes, education is important and you need to have a team with diverse people coming from different backgrounds and cultures to make sure, you know, you have like unbiased or, you know, less biased data, training data. So this is a good example. Pinterest has launched, you know, this new feature on their website, which allows for a search feature that filters the results by skin tone. The idea behind this is that those looking for beauty tips need to find relevant hair and makeup advice regardless of their race. So they said the skin tone search feature is a direct result of the diversity and inclusion team working closely with the technical and engineering team within the company. So Pinterest was one of the first tech companies to not only, you know, publicly release the annual company diversity report, but also set early public hiring goals. So Pinterest also reported that women now make up 47% of the company and 30% of people in technical roles at the company are women. This makes it one of the most gender diverse companies in the industry. You know, in fact, the Pinterest head of diversity and inclusion works hand in hand with the product and engineering team to produce more inclusive features on the site. And finally, they made gains in inclusivity by actually having more diverse range of thought at the table when developing their algorithm. So this is not the outcome of having the diversity team, right? You have more people sitting together and framing the algorithm, and each one of them, of their thought, is extremely important to bring it on the table to make sure we have system which is trustworthy and, you know, it sees that, you know, it sees with less bias in its eyes. And there are many standards that are currently being introduced on 8th April 2019 The European Union adopted ethics guidelines for trustworthy artificial intelligence. At a high level, let me walk you through what they are. So, the trustworthy AI should be lawful, ethical, and robust. It should respect all laws and regulation. It should respect the ethical principle and values. From a technical perspective, it should be robust, right? It should both from the technical perspective, also taking into the social environment to account. It should be robust, lawful, and ethical. So also they have set seven key requirement that AI system should meet in order to be termed as trustworthy. So these are the seven requirements. I hope you all can see on the screen. I'm just avoiding to read the same for the sake of time. And coming to the tools, right? LFAI, Linux Foundation. Linux Foundation. Sorry. Linux Foundation AI is a Linux Foundation project whose mission is to build and support open AI community and drive open source innovation in AI, ML, and deep learning domains by, enabling collaboration and creating new opportunity for all the members in the community. So recently, before that, I just want to give this is a starter note. Now we are going to talk about how IBM is contributing to open source tool that combat bias and increase transparency in AI. So as you can see on screen, these are the three tools, the three open source project that can help people take control of unwanted outcomes from the AI model. First is Adversarial Robustness 360 or ART toolkit. This tool prevents unwanted tampering of your model. Next one is AI Fairness 360. This helps you define and mitigate unwanted bias. And AI Explainability 360, it is AIX 360, helps you explain the process and outcome of your model. It makes AI model more explainable if you want to know why you are getting this result, right? So that's the tool that's being developed in our open source team. I'm just quickly pausing to see for more questions or thoughts.
Okay, so we have questions here from a data science perspective. What do you think happened in the arrest data example? Was there an additional component introduced, such as a risk factor multiplied against the individual that was higher against people of color? Like from a mechanism perspective, why does it care what color they are?
So it all depends. On the data you train, right? Let's say I have like 10 samples and I have eight, like seven of the samples of like one particular color and three of my sample in the other particular color, right? So you may not need to add anything. You may not need to, manipulate your data. Maybe your intention was not to really harm people, but somewhere knowingly or unknowingly, you give this data and your system learns it. So it has only learned, seven of 70%, of this particular color is going to commit crime. And next time when your machine is seeing the same similar kind of input, similar kind of people image of this particular color, it tends to give the same result, right? So knowingly or unknowingly, we are providing biased input to the machine that we are creating. So that's the reason I have mentioned. So you need to be educated. You need to know what kind of input you are giving to your system. You need to have a diverse team so that all of them can give, input. They can, let's say you are giving image to the input, right? If you have a diverse team, they can actually check, right? Okay, are you giving biased data or not? So it may not be intentional. At least I'm not aware of it. Knowingly or unknowingly, we are providing the data. We don't even have to manipulate it. The machine by itself is learning a biased data. If that answers your question.
Yeah, I think that probably got at it. Okay, Dorothy Gordon is asking if you said that the company that's was providing services to predict recidivism was still doing that, even when it's so clear that they're getting it wrong.
So they have renamed their company from to a, remain, they have renamed their company, and almost like it's still not has stopped as far as I know. And there are many uses of the algorithm even today. I don't want to quote what percent, because I am also learning from all the articles in the news that have been out. I am also doing research every single day to make myself aware of what is happening. So instead of quoting, some random numbers, I want to be transparent about it. Yes, it's not like it's not zero. The usage of the algorithm is still not zero.
Yeah, so there's a lot of topic or they're not really questions, they're statements talking about how sad it is that it is that way. You know, I mean, it is really sad. Somebody's asking about categorizing based on race and gender only when that's actually cogent or actually necessary.
Sorry, I didn't understand the question.
Well, the idea is that if you could, if it was possible to make gender and race details that you don't normally include in a rating algorithm like that.
Yeah, that's a great point, right? Now we are just providing some, let's say I'm just providing image to my system, right? It is learning, it is not learning a good from a good data. So adding those components, right? Adding a lot of additional information can actually make your system more trustworthy. So that's why I'm coming to the topic again. So these are the tools. These are could be a starter tools for us to explore what can be added, what can be removed, and how to interpret the explanation and take those feedback back to your model for retraining.
Cool. Now, Dorothy's asking again, given the scenario you're describing, is the solution ethics training or is it independent auditing of code or is it both things?
I would say it's both things, because some of the projects, some of the code is actually open source, so we get to play with it. And even as a user, you can just go to the code base and then start testing the result or how trustworthy the system is. But if it is actually in production, for example, to put it in a technical way, you may not get the code base of it, right? So we need to test, we need to keep, as a user, we need to keep testing it, and then we have to go back and give the prompt feedback. Also, we need to be educated. I have seen a lot of people not even knowing that such bias exists, right? So it's, and we may not realize when we create such an amazing system, all we want is to go and put it in the real world and then see how it works. But we have to ask question to ourselves, am I doing the right thing to the community, right? Yes, I've created the system. It's really good. It's really fascinating. But is it really trustworthy? So this educating, all these things, giving this principle when from right from when you're doing your schools and universities, it's extremely important to create a better world. I think it's a combination of both.
Great, thank you.
Sure.
That's all we have for questions for now. Do you want to continue?
So I'm gonna quickly go through different tools. I know I have like 10 more minutes, if I'm not wrong. So
You do?
yeah. So the first tool is AFNS360. It's a Python. We have it in both Python and R. So it contains a set of algorithms developed to control unwanted bias. So we have built three tutorials on credit scoring, predicting model medical expenditure, and classifying the face images by gender. So there is a proper guidance material that you can use to determine which metric and algorithm are most appropriate in any case, right? So this is an open source library of metrics. It will help you to examine, report, and mitigate discrimination and bias in machine learning model, and it works throughout the AI life cycle. What it contains is fairness metrics that will help you determine if your model or the data set has a bias or not. An explanation for these metrics are being provided. And once you detect the presence of bias in your system, we also have algorithm that will help you mitigate the bias in data set and model. So And you will need, I mean, this is not an easy problem to solve. We have over 70 metrics. We are trying to define, you know, every possible scenario of, you know, the fairness. And we're trying to build metrics around it. Now we have about 10 mitigation algorithms. So the word fairness is not easy to define. It is multifaceted depending on the context, and it's defined by the social construct. Our toolkit, you know, is useful towards achieving justice in many situations. But I want to put this, it cannot capture fairness in all the situation. This will be an excellent starting point for you to initiate conversation about fairness and then start exploring with your stakeholder. And in your developing, you know, process with the input on overall decision-making, like what, you know, when you're creating the workflow, you can actually introduce this tool and try to see how well it works in your situation. It's situation dependent, context dependent, right? And this toolkit only works when you have a well-defined problem, when you know what is actually causing it, when you know your business problem really well. So these are the disclaimers I would like to make about this tool. But this is an excellent point for you to start having conversation with your stakeholder. And yeah, there are three ways of using this tool. You can use it when you're creating your training data, when you're gathering your training data and doing your pre-processing, or you can even use this tool when you're building the model. And you can even use this tool once you've built your model. For example, let's say you don't have access to your data, you don't have access to your model building phase, but you have access to your evaluation and deployed model phase, right? That's when, so these are the flexible options to that we are providing before you that you can take and use in your application. And we have like cool demos here, and we also use the same Compass, you know, algorithm data set. We have accessed the data set used by ProPublica to do their analysis of their Compass algorithm. So you can actually play with the data set of the scores and see how you can use this tool to, you know, try mitigating the algorithm. So I'm going to, for the short of time, I'm going to just quickly provide you the materials to make sure my intention of this talk gets satisfied. I want to arm people with, you know, the good tools and projects that they can take back and use it. And this is the details I'll post in the chat as well. And the next toolkit is AI Explainability 360 Toolkit. So what it does, it's an open source library that help AI models and machine learning, AI and machine learning models. This library will help AI and machine learning models and their prediction to have a better explanation, right? Why I am getting this outcome. If I am being predicted with high risk score, then you need to know why, right? So this Python package includes a set of explainers, both at, you know, the model level and also the individual data level. And it explains why you are getting that outcome, to put it in a very simple way. So these are the different ways of explanation. There's one example that I can explain now. It's a global and local level, right? It will give you explanation as a whole model, why it predicts like that. And if you want to go like one by one instant, like why this person A is getting this outcome, why this person B is getting this outcome. So if you want to go person by person level, then you have option for that as well. So these are the supported algorithms. I have provided link to those papers. And if you want to know more about how it works, feel free to read about this paper. And believe me, these are super interesting to learn about and how it works. And this is a very simple example. This screenshot tells you, you know, how it tries to explain. It will give you, you know, top features that are playing a key role in your prediction. And it will display the factors that influence your prediction. And it weighs every single feature that are being used for your prediction. As a whole, you will get holistic view of what is happening in your model. And this is the public repository link that I would like to share. And we also have other tool like adversarial robustness toolkit that will help you. I can just quickly show here. Okay, I think my system kind of got stuck. So there is other tool called Adversarial Robustness Toolkit that will help you tamper with your algorithm. That will help you, you know, you can just go and try to see when your system breaks. You have algorithms, you have defense mechanism, attack mechanism, so you can initiate attack on your model and try to see how your you know, model responds. Even if you change one single pixel in an image, there are chances that your model prediction will be completely different. So this particular toolkit, Adversarial Robustness Toolkit, will help you having initiating attack in your model, and also we provide you different defense mechanism that you can use as a way to protect your model against those attack. And the next tool is the Model Asset Exchange tool. So transparency around the data and machine learning models could, you know, it can help you identify the bias, but we have open sourced some of the deep learning models. We have about 30 models. And here we are providing the ability for you to see the code and contribute to the model as such, right? Now we have seen toolkits like Fairness Toolkit, Explainability, Adversarial Robustness. Now we have Model Asset Exchange model. And we are open sourcing some of the model code where you can take it and play. So these models are available as a microservice. I'm gonna quickly go over it. I have like two more minutes. So we are providing you as a microservice, and that you can, you know, directly deploy in your Kubernetes, and then you can start testing the model to see where it actually you know, have the bias and the impact of the model in the real world. And the last is we also have this data asset exchange project. And here we solely focus on, you know, having betting the license, and we understand the source of your data, and we bet the proper license, and we make sure that the data that is being used by the models have, you know, a well-curated one. Everything is transparent, right? We have a proper set of metadata, proper licensing terms that you can read about it and then start using in your model. So these are our, you know, open source Sai trusted AI projects. I have links to everything here, and I have links to the Kodai trusted AI work. We are a group of 30 developers and data scientists working in these projects. And finally, I would like to end with this. So it's in our hands. We need to be responsible. We need to make sure, you know, everything that we do impacts in a good way. So maybe may or may not, we the creators of certain system unknowingly or unknowingly are hurting you know, some of the society, sexual sector of society. But let's think with responsibility. So instead of like blaming each other on building systems, I personally feel we as a society should come up and start building this together, right? We need to educate ourselves. Knowingly or unknowingly, certain things are happening, and we need to be aware, and we as a society should come up and create this system. And finally, I would like to thank Maureen, who really like helped with the presentation, and she was the one who is actually going to present. Since it's more about trusted AI and transparency, I want to thank Maureen for giving me this opportunity to interact with you all, and I hope you all had a great session. And these are the resources from this talk, which I will share with the moderator here, and we'll put this in probably for
Yeah,
reference.
I'll put it into the chat if you will send me a picture of that slide. Thank you
Sure.
very much. I have a question I've been holding on to for quite a while from the audience that I think you're the uniquely able to answer this question person. As I said at the top, we have some people who've been trying to understand bias during this day, and they've acknowledged bias they have, and they're just trying to figure out how it all fits together. So they're asking questions that have occurred to lots of people, and they're being brave about asking them. This question is, could bias be a network effect or an emergent property like traffic slowdowns on the freeway? No one wants to go slow, but we can't go faster. Even if no one was actually biased, maybe it just arises. Maybe if we all drive politely and safely, we can't speed up. That might be a hard problem to solve, and appealing to drivers won't do a lot of good. Maybe we need to redesign freeway interchanges. So he's basically arguing for changes in infrastructure, which is the very thing you're talking about. Do you want to make a comment about that?
Yeah, I mean, this is like my personal comment. Whenever I talk about bias, I always have this compassion, because, when you create an AI system, we all have this excitement, right? I'm creating something for my society. I'm making the process better. Sometimes over the oversight, we might lose certain things. And even as a human, we all should, I mean, it's a statement that we all are biased in one or the other ways. Even with the dress we put, when we see the dress, at times we feel, okay, this might not be good. Even when you see a person, oh, we judge in a moment, right? Even as a human, we have bias. So I would like to see this problem in a more compassionate way. Each one of us are responsible, and now things have become more and more open. Like, people are hearing us, right? So yes, the system is out, the process is being made more efficient, but you need the feedback system to see what is good, what is wrong. We need to be extremely interactive as a community. We have to work together. This is not one particular problem. This is not a problem of one person. The problem as a society we need to solve.
Yeah, it's a complex system.
Yeah. I
And
hope that.
seriously institutionalized too, because many people don't even realize that they are participating in it.
Yeah, exactly right. Like, we need to be aware of it. It's like a feedback thing. We need to make sure we don't, let, even if there is some bias that you see, we immediately have to report it without any delay. We should not take this for granted.
Now, here's a very interesting question. Hashim, who I think must be a man, is asking if there's an example of system or code biased against men or against white groups.
This is something, to be honest, I always feel equality is not in one particular example. Like, so most of the time we speak about bias against women or bias against a particular race or colored people, and there is other side as well. So I am particularly interested in knowing about the other side. So what I usually, whenever I end this conversation, whenever I have conversation with my colleagues about it, I want to know the bias that exists on the other side. I want to see examples, that these the other aspect or the other race or other color aspect, right? I'm pretty sure there must be some, although it may not be, as equal
Well,
for
there might be some sports analogies where, there's certain sports that used to be predominantly white and are not now predominantly white. And there's probably some interesting things to look at there, I'm guessing.
Yeah, as someone who's practicing data science every day, I'm looking for data sets to have those examples as well. And I'm pretty sure very soon we are going to have examples that see men, women, what is the bias against this? And I mean, for example, right? For example, let's take two. What are the bias against this and also bias against that community? So very soon we are going to host all the example, and there are a lot of work that is being done, and I'm also a part of that work as well. So yes, if you could, if you follow those, Twitter accounts, we follow those repository, soon those will be published as well.
Cool. All right. And then Pamelia Miller is asking again what steps to take to fix these problems. And we did talk about that earlier, but maybe that would be a good way to wrap it up. What do you think the short path is to getting through this, even acknowledging that it's a complex problem?
Yes, the first, as you have mentioned, I'm going to start from the last point that you mentioned. We need to acknowledge that this problem exists, right? And not every single person, knowingly or unknowingly, are contributing data towards the system. We need to be aware of where the data is being used, and we need to be aware of what is there any system behind the decision. If first, we need to start asking why. Start asking why is very, very important from my perspective. If you are getting some results, if you are getting some, prediction outcomes, you should ask. And if you feel that you don't deserve it, if you feel that it's against you, let's all start speaking up and let's start understanding why behind everything. So that's the first point, awareness. From the technical perspective, I would like to have the team which is more diverse to make sure I have, points, data from every single aspect of the society, every single group from the society, right? So That is something I would like to have, and you need to be aware of the tools. Whatever I have mentioned today are like 5 or 6 examples, but if you go to the Linux Foundation Trusted AI map, that landscape map, you have so many tools to explore. So let's all get awareness of this, acknowledge that this problem exists, and see, okay, where this problem exists, what are the tools, and start playing with the tools and be more interactive in the community, and you know, just be more transparent, and then start interacting and try. We can't 100% eliminate, because as a human we also have bias, but at least we will try making it happen.